ask that we take a minute to remember our dear friend Kathleen Hassan, who worked with us for many, many years. And as such, I just ask that we take a moment of silence to remember her, please. Thank you very much. And also, if you would note on the agenda, we'll be adding another item. It'll be item number C. Dave wants to give us an update on the disparity study. So we'll do that. But other than that, let's go to work here, Mr. Hansen, we go through the budget process.
Yes, sir. We're still in the CIP phase before we provide the, at the end of the month, the city manager's operating budget. And so today we have Parks and Recreation, Chad Morris, representing our director for Parks and Recreation, Michael Calvert, who's with us today. And remember that your CIP briefings are presented to you without adjustments that the city manager will be adding to the FY18 budget. So what you're getting is you're getting the current program, and then you're getting the requested but yet to be funded project.
Very
so with
good.
That, Chad.
Glad to have you, Chad.
Good afternoon, Mayor, members of council. I'm pleased to bring forward the Parks and Recreation CIP for FY18 to 2023. And also to highlight some of our accomplishments that we've had completed recently. But first, I'd like to spend a few minutes describing how the Parks and Recreation CIP helps advance the city's goals. The vision of the Parks and Recreation Department is a balanced, sustainable, and value-focused system of parks, recreation, and public spaces that create a sense of community. Without a solid Parks and Recreation Capital Improvement Program, the city's goals and community priorities simply would not progress. Through our current CIP program, we've been able to improve connectivity by having 63% of Virginia Beach residents live within a 10-minute walk time, and that's excluding the rural south. There are currently 288 miles of bikeways, trails, and wide sidewalks, as well as Virginia Beach is recognized as a bronze-level bicycle-friendly community by the League of American Bicyclists. We also contribute to maintaining quality of life. The 2015 Virginia Beach Citizen Satisfaction Survey measured that 97% were satisfied overall with the community's recreation centers, and almost 94% were satisfied with the city parks. 96% agreed with the statement that Virginia Beach is a good place to live. As for improving, as far as protecting the environment, there are 3.2 million trees in the city, covering 38% of Virginia Beach, which also contributes to over $263 million in annual savings and environmental benefits for residents. Improving community health and wellness. There are over 50,000 recreation center members with over 1.4 recreation membership card scans last year. And over 2.9 million visits have been made to our parks in 2016. We also provide safe community gathering places. Virginia Beach Parks and Recreation manages 287 park sites, more than 7,000 acres of parks and open space property, six soon to be seven community recreation centers, a municipal marina, and an athletic complex, all of which are safe for our residents and visitors to enjoy. And finally, for increasing sports tourism. In fall of 2016, the Princess Anne Athletic Complex synthetic turf field project was completed as a way to boost the opportunity for Virginia Beach to be a contender for regional athletic tournament venues in sports, field sports such as soccer, football, lacrosse, and rugby. The project increases the program playability by an additional 5,000 hours a year and provides more opportunity for our visitors to stay in Virginia Beach and stay in our Virginia Beach hotels and to dine in Virginia Beach restaurants. The chart shown on this slide is a deliberate focus of the Parks and Recreation CIP for both the short term and the 6-year long term. The facility repair and renovation category, which is shown in red, dominates the program. In FY18, $5.8 million of the $6.7 million CIP budget is proposed for facility repair and renovation. Many of our current parks and recreation facilities are aging and are in need of capital repair and or replacement. As you'll be able to see in the upcoming slides, our focus is heavily targeted on capital maintenance type projects. Listed here are 8 CIP project titles that are considered parks and recreation new facility development. In FY18, only 2 projects have requested funding, mostly because the project titles have been already fully funded or the programs were reduced. Bikeways and trails implementation is our only real continuation of developing new parks and recreation facilities. The open space site acquisition funding you see here for FY18 is simply a proper transfer from the planning department that's collected when newly created lots are created in the transition area. The next 2 slides show the breakdown of CIP projects that fall under the category of facility repair and renovation. There are currently 14 project titles created for this facility repair and renovation. This is a continuation slide showing facility repair and renovation projects. I'd like to note that the funding in 4305 and the ability to keep our tennis courts in good condition is a concern. The city currently has 188 tennis courts in our aging system, many of which were constructed about the same time. The backlog of these tennis court capital repair and replacement has created an issue for us. The simplest milling and paving of a tennis court, a double tennis court in a neighborhood park, usually costs around $100,000. And the replacement cost for 8 courts, such as a high school facility, is around $350,000. Fortunately, we have been able to create great partnerships with the Virginia Beach City Public Schools, where a cost-sharing effort has been coordinated for the replacement of tennis courts at the school sites. And finally, one project we have under the title of facility replacement is for playground replacements, which is about $400,000 a year. I'm pleased to bring to your attention a couple of exciting projects that are underway for our department. CIP 4509 is the replacement of Kempsville Recreation Center. This 87,000 square foot facility replaces the city's first community recreation center, which opened in 1977. I'd definitely like to take the time to thank Public Works, who's overseeing the construction and contractual obligations on this project, and also to the others who and other departments who have contributed as well, especially to the City Council who have championed our last 3 recreation centers, including Williams Farm, Bow Creek, and now the wonderful Kempsville Recreation Facility. There are many great amenities that the community will be able to enjoy, as well as a sustainable facility. We're shooting for LEED Silver, and that will continue to provide quality fitness and recreation for many, many years to come. We're also eagerly working with scheduling the grand opening on June 8th, so we hope to see you all there for this event. Another Parks and Rec facility currently under construction is CIP 4503, which is the Parks and Recreation Administration Building. This long-awaited project will relocate 115 Parks and Recreation members to a new 27,000 square foot facility located at the Princess Anne Commons area near the Princess Anne Athletic Complex. Team members are currently located at the Municipal Center in buildings 19 and 21, and also at the infamous 2289 Lynnhaven Parkway, which is also known as the Citywide Offices. Groundbreaking occurred in June, and the steel structural elements have been erected, and 90% of the stud work framing is completed, with plumbing, mechanical, and electrical work currently underway. Anticipated construction is for December 2017 with a move-in date, hopefully by February 2018. 4064 is the Bikeways and Trails Implementation CIP, which funds new biking infrastructure throughout the city. Projects selected are usually based on recommendations from the City Bikeways and Trails Plan and the Virginia Beach Outdoors Plan. Recent accomplishments include shoulder widening of Western Shore Drive, which was combined with a project with Public Works, which has been recently completed. Also, FY18 projects include connector paths between Bromfield and Lakeview Avenues, a bike pedestrian counting study, and matching funds for the Thalia Creek Greenway and Buckner Boulevard projects. 4306 and 308 are part of the Parks and Recreation Open Space Program. 4306 is for the open space park development and maintenance. It includes master planning improvements for all property acquired through the city open space acquisition program. Even with the reduction of funding for open space program a couple of years ago, there are still a couple of projects that have occurred or are underway with the balance of the funds. Those projects include Marshview Park and also the modest improvements that were made to Pungo Ferry Landing, which opened to the public last fall. 4308 is the open space program site acquisition, which has also been very successful in the past. CIP funds the acquisition of property planned for preservation or future improvement for recreational purposes. With the past success of the open space program, we would like to ask for consideration the restoration of the program dedication from 0.22% to the original 0.44% of the restaurant meals tax. Understanding our mission and focus is not necessary on acquisition of open space properties at this time. However, there is an important role that our parks and open spaces will play in providing green solutions in combating issues such as sea level rise, recurrent flooding, and flood mitigation. Combining the functionality of a stormwater solution and the aesthetics and amenities of a park site provides multiple benefits to the city and to our citizens. The restoration of the program dedication could also serve as a viable solution to the backlog of parks and recreation infrastructure capital replacement that exists in our aging system. 4079 is for the Thalia Creek Greenway Phase 3. This is an exciting project for the design and construction of approximately 1,200 linear feet of paved trail and raised boardwalk that will connect from Phase 2, which Phase 2 is the section behind Midtown Apartments, which curls down to Bonnie Road. So this Phase 3 section connects to Phase 2 and heads west to Independence Boulevard. This Phase 3 project is currently under design at 30%. Princess Anne Athletic Complex multi-purpose field renovations, which I mentioned earlier. This project renovated the multi-purpose rectangular natural turf athletic fields. The accomplishment included the construction of the new synthetic turf multi-purpose rectangular fields and the conversion of three existing rectangular fields from grass to synthetic turf, as well as the installation of new field lighting for two of the rectangular fields. Construction of a new lighted 230-space parking area is also planned for Phase 2 and will be completed in the winter of 2017. 4080 is the Sportsplex and Field Hockey Training Center, which funds major capital repairs and renovations at these two facilities. These facilities are currently operated through a management agreement, while the city still has the obligation of capital maintenance. Recent accomplishments at the Sportsplex include sports field lighting upgrade, hot water system replacement, and multiple HVAC unit replacements. Future improvements include the repair and replacement of the Sportsplex building roof and painting of the exposed structural steel. Also, a condition assessment is currently underway at the Sportsplex by city staff to determine if there are additional funding resources that may be needed for major capital repairs. 4300, which is the Community Recreation Center repairs renovation, funds preventative maintenance, capital repairs, and capital renovations for the city's soon to be seven community recreation centers. Due to high attendance and a heavy use of the city's recreation centers, these facilities require regular preventive maintenance as well as capital repairs and renovations in order to effectively maintain these facilities. Every effort is made to bundle related projects to reduce total project costs and to design projects to maximize the utilization of Energy Star equipment and or other sustainable materials that will result in a reduced maintenance cost and reduced energy consumption during the life cycles of equipment and materials. Recent accomplishments are assisted care changing facilities and a cardio room, HVAC dehumidification at Princess Anne Rec Center, and marketing digital signage boards at six of the recreation centers. Current projects are underway are assisted care changing facilities and cardio room HVAC dehumidification at Bayside and Great Neck as well. Future projects to look forward to are locker room renovations at Princess Anne, Bayside, and Great Neck Recreation Centers, pool ceiling repairs, and light fixture replacements, as well as parking lot resurfacing at multiple centers. 4301 is Parks and Special Use Facilities Development and Renovations. The citywide network of neighborhood parks, community parks, metro parks, signature parks, and special use facilities is an invaluable asset to the city. This initiative funds the numerous capital renovations and replacements that are required in order for the city to continue to provide quality recreational facilities to all residents of the community. Recent accomplishments from 4301 include improvements to Great Neck Park, including re-roofing of park shelters, sidewalks, and ADA modifications, as well as replacements of other amenities such as trash cans and dumpsters, enclosures. Also improvements to Stony Brook Dunwoody neighborhood parks were completed. Future projects include basketball court replacements at various park sites, asphalt walkway repairs at various parks, and Woodstock Park shelter replacements and restroom park office replacement at Mount Trashmore. 4303, which is for greenways, scenic waterways, and natural areas. Virginia Beach is interconnected with a series of extensive natural linear open spaces that consist of open marshes and wooded swamplands. These greenways provide significant environmental benefits to the city by providing open space and recreational amenities is significant, and these areas need to be preserved and managed as greenways for the future well-being of the city. The Virginia Beach Waterway Network provides a unique recreational opportunity for residents to enjoy various bodies of fresh and salt water throughout the city. Many of these water bodies are interconnected and provide a unique habitat for wildlife and marine life. Recent accomplishments with 4303 include the urban forest analysis, and in FY18, the plan is to fund the replacement of the Hutton Circle ADA accessible kayak launch as part of a combination with Public Works dredge pier construction project, which is in the design phase. 4506, the Parks Infrastructure Renewal Replacement CIP, funds the implementation of capital renovations and replacements to the infrastructure in signature metro and community parks, as well as special use facilities. CIP 4301, which was mentioned earlier, and this CIP go hand in hand and provide the largest benefit in reference to making needed capital improvements to park facilities. Recent accomplishments include improvements made at Little Island Park, basketball courts replacements at Munden Point, and parking lot improvements at Bayville Park. Future projects include capital maintenance to the parking lots at Red Mill Farms, Lynn Haven Park, and Woodstock Park. Moving on to the first of three projects listed above, available funding is the Lynn Haven Marina bulkhead replacement and facility renovation. The need for this project is due to the unexpected bulkhead failure that occurred at the Lynn Haven Marina facility in March of 2016. Bulkhead failure forced the closure of the marina building, which housed restroom facilities, a pump-out facility for marine toilets, and an office storage space that provides critical infrastructure to enhance response times and availability of public safety assets, which include the Virginia Beach Police Marine Patrol, Virginia Beach Fire Marine Response Team, and Virginia Beach Department of Emergency Medical Services Marine Response Team. So why does the city have a marina to operate? The city has an agreement with the Army Corps of Engineers to maintain and operate a marina facility in exchange for the Army Corps of Engineers maintenance along the Long Creek Channel, and an additional commitment to provide a no-fee pump-out facility in the Lynn Haven River. The city has been the beneficiary of this no-cost dredging work with an estimated value of over $30 million. So the city certainly has gained a lot of mileage by operating this facility. The current situation at the marina is the design for the new bulkhead is funded and will be complete by June 17, and the marina building has since been demolished. The request is for $1.87 million in FY18 for phase one construction, which includes replacement of the 250-foot a failed bulkhead section, replace the marina building, convert two slips to ADA, and to assess the condition of the remainder of the marina facility. Also requesting in $1.1 million in FY19 for the design and construction of additional marina repair renovation work that may be needed, depending on the results of the facility assessment, which is to be conducted. The second request project above available funding is the Euclid Combined Operations Facility replacement. The Euclid facility, located at 100 Southgate Avenue, is an operations center for the Department of Parks and Recreation, Landscape Management, and the Department of Public Works Highway Operations, as well as fleet management fueling station. Operations conducted at the Euclid site include 4 to 6 highway operations crews performing street maintenance and other repairs, and 37 landscape management personnel providing grounds maintenance services to parks, public buildings, and school grounds. Both work groups provide services in the areas north of Virginia Beach Boulevard. The existing facility provides bulk storage of material used in the day-to-day operations for both work groups and salt sand mixtures to support 16 additional crews in snow removal operations. The fueling station has a storage capacity of 20,000 gallons each of diesel and gasoline, which also provides 30% of the full fuel used in all city vehicles. The fueling station is supported by an emergency generator to maintain operations during power outages. The entire Euclid Yard site was identified over 10 years ago as being one of the top 12 city facilities rated in the poorest condition in need of replacement. A satellite location in the northern part of the city allows for increased efficiencies and reduced costs compared to providing the same level of service from the department's operations facilities on Dam Neck Road. The efficiencies and cost savings are from reduced labor, fuel, and vehicle maintenance costs associated with the shorter commute to the northern service area on a daily basis. The new facility provides 26,000 square foot of offices, storages and mechanic shops, parking for 40 employees, outdoor storage for bulk materials, and a fueling facility. The $13.3 million request does not include site acquisition, suggesting the facility could remain at its current location and redeveloped, or the facility be relocated to another city-owned site of 5 to 7 acres in the northwest quadrant of the city. However, relocation options have been quite a challenge. The final requested project above available funding is for the Owl Creek Marina. This request would fund the design and infrastructure improvements to pave the Owl Creek Municipal Boat Ramp and provide a separate ADA accessible canoe kayak launch facility. This water-dependent amenity is heavily used launch facility, providing boat, kayak, canoe, paddleboard access to the Owl Creek watershed, and is the only public boat launch facility with direct access to the Atlantic Ocean. Currently, the 93,000 square foot of parking area, of that approximately 85% is unpaved and requires periodic grading and the addition of road-based material to fill in ruts and potholes. During rain events, sediment washes directly into Owl Creek. This project would improve water quality through the reduction of sediment runoff from the existing unpaved parking lot. Seasonally, the area is congested with power and non-powered watercraft launching out of the same location, posing safety concerns. Plus, the use of adjacent Camp Pendleton as an overflow boat trailer parking area will not be available any longer, which will create more of a parking concern on major event days. An ADA-compliant canoe, kayak, paddleboard launch facility at this site that is separate from the main boat ramp would be provided. We're requesting $250,000 in FY18 for design of these facility improvements and $1.76 million in FY19 for construction. That's all I have today, and thank you for your time, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Questions, please? John Moss?
I noticed on the first couple slides, if you take your FY18 request, that's on your matrix slides up front, or tables, we want to call them, and you multiply that by six, that's the number that comes out for the six-year period, which I would think that either one, you're getting 2 or 3% or 4% your proficiency, or your overall program is underpriced because it doesn't account for inflation. Because when you take that last column, 475, multiply it by six, you get 2.8 million. And as you go through all of these slides, with rare exception, they're priced out as if there's no price adjustments over a six-year period. I think that's probably a little bit optimistic, but if you're going to get those kind of efficiencies, I think that's great. But just so you note that I think it's underpriced. My other observation as you look at all these things is probably this is a time we probably should create a depreciation sinking fund where we, because there's a lot of stuff we're maintaining, capital plan and buildings, and then the things could be within it, and then we could understand whether or not we can afford to take on new stuff because we can't afford to maintain the stuff we have. And this doesn't come across on this item-by-item look, but there's a tremendous amount of maintenance, especially with pool places. That's just a suggestion. I have commented on this before, but I want to bring it out again. If you will note on slide 8, and I realize this includes all the land and building, but when you look at the construction cost per square foot, it was $368.47 for Kentsville Rec Center with a pool, and it's $427 a square foot for the Parks and Recreation admin building. I have talked about frequently, we have got to do better. And my last observation would be, I think that some of the stuff that's above the line, like the Rudy stuff that we know we have to do, has to be done at the expense of something that's already in the program that needs to come out. And I think in the end, Mr. Mayor, I think we're going to look at all the stuff that's even within the line. Is this stuff in here more important than taking care of the public safety issue of flooding? I know the manager is going to do that, but I'm telling you, as I look at these projects, it's not that I don't think parks and recreation is important, but people's homes being protected by flooding is more important.
Thank you, John. Barbara?
Well, I certainly think that when we look at our citizens and the rate at which they use our parks and recreation facilities, it's certainly one of those things that everybody, when I hear people talking about what's good about the city, they immediately start talking about some of the recreational opportunities. And I think having the Kempsville Rec Center open this year is going to be a really a tremendous thing and for the whole city. But just to mention about the open space program, of course, it's wound down from its acquisition, but now in looking at the ongoing development and maintenance, and you know, maybe this is what some of what John's talking about. But I think when we look at what the city has acquired through that open space program, which we adopted in 1999-2000 as one of our major projects, and we funded it with something a little less than half of a cent on the meal tax. And throughout this time, you know, that money, that $50 million plus, it's been leveraged with some grants and other things, and it's made some really tremendous purchases which make a great difference in the city. This first big one, I guess, was the Stumpy Lake project. And when we look at that, or we look at Pleasure House Point, or, you know, we could just go all around the city and name the things that have come about with that project. And I just want to thank the people who have served on the Open Space Committee. I think three of the people who are on there have been on for the duration, Tuck Bowie and Lily Gilbert and Cale Warren, have really been dedicated to this, and Barbara Duke was really dedicated as a staff person. And they've done just an outstanding job. But when you look at these projects, and I think Chad made this point, look at what these purchases provide. They not only provide the parks and recreation advantages, but there are so many multiple outcomes with each of these projects that we've been able to achieve, whether it's historical preservation or stormwater improvement or just so many other things besides just the parks component. And I think, you know, when we look at a lot of these were sensitive areas that we really didn't want to see develop, and we were able to bring them in as great recreational opportunities, as well as achieving some other things or avoiding some problems that we would have had some of them developed. I look at Pleasure House Point and I envision over 1,000 units there, and I think, oh my goodness, am I ever glad.
And commercial.
We managed.
Yeah, but who's counting, right?
So this is not just an open space, parks and recreation accomplishment, but it's really so many other things across the board, and I think that the parks and recreation people can really be thanked for all that they've done over the last, I guess now, 17 years with that program, and now making sure we put the rest of them in operation. And I'm just so glad we were able to have as the final legacy purchase, I guess, that Pungo Ferry property, which of course was zoned B4 and just waiting for something to go there that would have been totally out of character with the area. But that is going to be one of our legacy purchases too, as we see that over time.
Very good. Other questions or comments?
One follow-up off it. Please, on Euclid John. Road, I know there'll be a business cost analysis of that, but it'll be interesting to note when you do that analysis, the incremental cost, is whether or not contracting with private concerns that already have a footprint that's closer in commuting distance that can provide the very same service, whether or not that's more cost-effective than trying to relocate and be closer if truly distance and fuel and things is driving it. Are there private sector providers that are in the vicinity that you wouldn't have to duplicate that footprint and therefore would give them a competitive advantage as a provider?
Other questions or comments? Thank you so very much.
Thank you all. Have a great day.
Appreciate what y'all are doing over there. Okay. Phil Davenport, Stormwater, buddy. We're glad to have you.
Okay, just when you thought you'd seen everything about stormwater, we're giving it to you again. This is not going to be a lot different than what we showed you in December and what we again discussed with you later in January. As the city manager said at the beginning of the meeting, what we're showing you today is based on the CIP proposal that we in Public Works developed several months ago without any of the adjustments that the city manager may be making when he offers his recommendation to city council in a couple of weeks. So, let's see.
Phil's right to Shannon.
Oh, okay. All right.
You want it? You got it. There you go, buddy.
Okay, so we are going to have several people that talk to you today. I'm just going to be up very briefly to do an introduction, and we're going to be followed by Mike Monday, who will do the presentation portion about flooding projects, then Melanie Coffey about the regulatory compliance, and then Mark Johnson about the maintenance aspect. Cheryl Cole was going to be here today doing the maintenance, but we think she might be in Chicago at the airport trying to get here still. So anyway, so this is just a little bit of what our agenda will look like for today. We're not going to spend any time on that. So what is stormwater? Drainage, it's flood control, it's water quality, it's regulatory compliance, it's operations and management, it's asset management, and it's the whole program of all of those things combined. Just as a very, very brief working definition, what is stormwater management? It's basically handling the excess rainfall. Not all rainfall is excess, as the farmers will certainly tell you, but we do have some excess that comes down occasionally. So it's trying to manage that excess runoff. So we're trying to address flood control, water quality, the regulatory compliance, and all of our operations and maintenance. The stormwater quality is kind of the newest piece of all of this, although it has been around for a while now. It's still the newest piece, but sometimes the lines change a little bit. Certainly with Matthew, some of the emphasis has moved a little bit away from the regulatory compliance, although we still are required to do it, and there are fines if we don't. We certainly have a much bigger role now to take care of some of the flooding issues. And then we also have, if that weren't enough, we have the sea level rise and an increasing frequency of severe storms. The way our funding breaks down, based on our current amount of funding, the $40 million a year that we currently are taking in from our stormwater management fee, about 65% of it is related to our maintenance, and then the rest of it is spread out among the stormwater quality and the flood control projects. We have a CIP program which includes some elements of all of those that right now is about $22.3 million per year. Some of our recently completed projects, just within the last year, the Owls Creek Boat Ramp Pump Out Facility, a couple of major drainage projects, three major drainage projects in the southern part of the city, and dredging of five lakes over in Brigadoon. Some of our current construction projects. Over in the Cape Henry area, we have three tide gates that are being installed as we speak. These will be up in the Cape Henry ditch. They will be computer controlled. We already have five gate valves on some of the ditches that kind of backflow in when the tide gets too high. So this will be just one more step in trying to minimize the amount of flooding in that area. North Lake Holly Section 4, South Lake Holly Sections 1 and 2, all under construction. Those are some projects that have been going on for many years, as Mr. Earn can attest to. It's taken years because they're, first of all, very big projects. We can't tear up every bit of the neighborhood at one time, and the money has kind of forced us to stretch them out a little bit. And Thalia Drive culvert improvements, this is an area where we've got some restricted flows, and if you look over there at the bottom right, that's what it kind of looks like. And we are replacing that with three box culverts. Each will be about 3 feet by 7 feet, and we should be able to move a lot more water. Some of our other major initiatives going on, we have our development of our comprehensive citywide response plan to sea level rise, and that's with us working with Dewberry Engineers. Our citywide stormwater master planning analysis and inventory, working with CDM, and those two kind of go hand in hand. And we are participating very actively with a lot of different groups on sea level rise and stormwater management. And some of those include ODU, the Georgetown Law School with their climate center, William and Mary Law School, Virginia Tech, the Navy, DEQ, CDM, HRPDC, Dewberry, and there's a host of others. We could spend all of our time going to sea level rise meetings if we chose to do that, but we do run out of time. The program that we have submitted within our target level funding for our capital improvement is shown here. I'm not going to talk to every one of these projects, but Mike Mundy and others will be talking about them. And as you see, it's about $22 million a year over the six-year period. That does not address all of our above-target requests. Again, these are projects we've shown you before back in December, and we'll talk about each one of those individually also. And this is the same number, about $450 million, that everybody has seen before. So we'll talk about those, and then we will stand ready to answer any questions.
Michael, we're glad to have you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, council members. I'm going to keep it moving pretty quick. Stop me if you have any questions. Aragona drainage improvements will address drainage inadequacies in the Aragona subdivision. Evaluation of the existing system identified improvements for Sullivan Boulevard and Whistler Lane, which are scheduled for construction in early 2018. The project is currently in the design phase and has a balance to completion of nearly $1.4 million. Baker Road culvert and ditch improvement project is being coordinated with the SGA office and development improvements for Burton Station. The project includes culvert improvements under Baker Road and ditch improvements both upstream and downstream of the culvert. The project is currently in the acquisition phase and construction is scheduled to occur in early part of 2018. Bellamy Manor outfall ditch project will provide improvements to the existing primary combination pipe ditch drainage system located within the neighborhood. The project includes bank stabilization of backyard residential outfall ditches and channels. The project is scheduled to be advertised in May of this year, and construction will be about a year. Central Resort District is approximately 300 acres in area. The project will include stormwater collection system improvements, stormwater pump stations, ocean outfall systems, and tidal backflow prevention devices. This improvement project will be evaluated and developed in multiple phases, coordinating with future development of the Central Resort District. Early estimates show this project exceeding $110 million in total cost. The Comprehensive Sea Level Rise Reoccurrent Flooding Analysis Project is responsible for analyzing the four major watersheds located within the city. The goals include identifying the probable extent of sea level rise reoccurrent flooding impacts, evaluating appropriate adaptation strategies in the vulnerable areas, identifying budgetary costs for engineered protection measures and other adaptation programs. The Lynn Haven River watershed area will be completed by fall of 2017. The remaining three watersheds will be completed in the next 2 years. And just a side note, the city received a grant in 2016 from NOAA for $800,000 to support this study. College Park and Level Green Improvement Project will address drainage inadequacies in the two subdivisions. The project is currently in the preliminary design phase. First phase construction improvements are scheduled to begin in fall 2018. Eastern Shore Drive drainage improvement project includes three new pump stations and replacement of an existing pump station that will all discharge into Long Creek. The anticipated total CIP project cost exceeds $80 million. Funding has been approved for the design and partial acquisition for phase one and two. The Neighborhood Stormwater Infrastructure Improvement 2 project addresses neighborhood stormwater infrastructure improvements and includes correcting drainage problems in various established neighborhoods and other areas that fall beyond the scope of normal maintenance, but do not meet the criteria to stand as a separate CIP project. Our current two projects are 24th and a half street improvements, which began construction in February of this year, and Thalia Drive culvert replacement project, which began construction in this month, 2017. Both projects will be about a 4-month construction. North Lake Holly Watershed Improvement Project is a multiple outcome project which incorporates sewer and water service upgrades as well as street renovations, drainage improvements, and other improvements to one of the oldest residential areas in the city. Section 4 began construction in September 2016. It's a 15-month project. Section 3 began, Section 3 has been broken into two phases to accommodate funding. Section 3A is scheduled to go to construction in June 2017, and that's about a 30-month project. Section 1C includes embankment improvements along North Lake Holly and is scheduled to begin construction in 2019. South Lake Holly Watershed Improvement Project is also another one of our multiple outcome projects. Section 1 and 2 are under construction and scheduled to be complete in June 2017. Section 4 is the last phase of the project and is scheduled to begin construction in July 2017. Its construction will be a little over 2 years in length. The Southern Canal Lee Ditch Culvert Improvement Project is for the design and construction of drainage improvements to canal, lee ditches, culverts, and roadways located in the southern watershed. The next projects are located along Charity Neck Road and Pleasant Ridge Road, and they're located in the red circles on the map. The blue circles represent the completed project areas. The Stormwater Modeling Master Plan Analysis and Inventory Project is updating the city stormwater master plans that were prepared in the late 1980s. It is developing comprehensive city stormwater management plans and models that fully integrate stormwater quality and quantity control and management for each watershed. It also identifies deficiencies in the stormwater management system, considering both stormwater quality and quantity, and alternatives for needed upgrades and improvements. The Lynn Haven River 7 sub-watersheds shown shaded on the map will be completed this fall 2017. The additional funding request is necessary to complete the model portion of this project in the next 3 years by FY20. Windsor Woods area experiences flooding during minor to moderate rainfall events. Additionally, the neighborhood experiences widespread residential home flooding during, it experienced widespread residential home flooding during Hurricane Matthew. Current funding addresses channel maintenance dredging of Northgate Channel and Windsor Woods Canal, which are scheduled to begin construction in May 2017. Both projects are currently being advertised for construction, and both are about a year in construction length. Early estimates show the drainage improvements for Windsor Woods section exceeding $31 million. The next four projects are new above-target unfunded neighborhood drainage improvement projects. The Princess Anne Plaza area experiences flooding during minor to moderate rainfall events. The drainage improvements will include stormwater pump stations, tide control devices, and storm drain pipe improvements. Early estimates show this project exceeding $66 million in total cost. The Lakes area experiences flooding during moderate rainfall events in addition to being tidally impacted from London Bridge Canal. The drainage improvements will include stormwater pump stations, tide control devices, and storm drain pipe improvements. Early estimates show this project exceeding $28 million in total cost. The project will most likely be coordinated with Windsor Wood Drainage Project and the Princess Anne Plaza Drainage Project due to its tidal connection with London Bridge Canal and also the Lynn Haven River. During intense rainfall events and windblown tidal events that are accompanied with moderate rain events, Asheville Park experiences widespread flooding. This project will provide necessary drainage improvements to alleviate roadway flooding and residential structural flooding. Early estimates show this project cost at $35 million. The two lakes located within Sherwood Lakes are being influenced by groundwater and current water surface elevations within the lake are approximately 18 to 24 inches higher than original design. This reduces the available stormwater storage capacity within the lakes, and roadway flooding is occurring during moderate rainfall events. Extreme road layer flooding occurred during this fall's 2016 severe weather events, which made the neighborhood roads impassable for several days. Early estimates show this project costed $20 million. Now I'll hand it over to Melanie Coffany, who heads up our regulatory compliance section. We'll keep it moving.
Melanie, we're glad to have you.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council. Thank you, Mike.
You're welcome.
Okay, now I'd like to talk with you mostly about the primary functions of the water quality and regulatory compliance programs. These CIPs are really about implementing our MS4 permit programs and also the construction of projects to meet our local TMDLs and Chesapeake Bay TMDL requirements. CIP 7042, under the Clean Water Act, the city is considered a pollutant discharge system, just like an industrial facility, like a wastewater treatment plant. So we're regulated by the EPA through the DEQ to manage our stormwater system and prevent pollution through our system by the MS4 permit. So there are many required programs. I'm not going to talk about all of them today. But the project basically is going to be used to implement all of these different mandated requirements. The project has a current funding of $1.1 million a year, and the additional need is about $1.3 million a year. CIP 7414, this is Stormwater Quality Improvements, Phase 2. This project is really focused on identification and design of construction of stormwater management facilities, and it includes our regional cost participation projects citywide. The projects are implemented both to meet the regulatory compliance with the Chesapeake Bay TMDL and the local water TMDLs. So these projects will help reduce pollution in our local waters and throughout the city. We've also just begun a citywide comprehensive water quality monitoring program that's also required by the permit. And this project has funding of $1.15 million a year with an additional need of $2.34 million a year. And I did add a note about the HRSD SWIFT program that we've been talking about. And all of these costs are based on the approval of SWIFT, just to make sure I'll know that part. The next one.
Go back and say that one more time.
Sure. The costs that are in here, the additional above target need, that is based on the approval of HRSD SWIFT. That would...
program that would give us credits?
Yes, correct. Yes, sir. That's the second and third phases may be reduced by the HRSD SWIFT approval. So that's part of their plan, is to meet the pollutant requirements, reduction requirements under those two phases. So they are not agreeing to meet our first phase requirements. So that's what this is focused on.
Just so the council understands the magnitude of the TMDL requirements, when you take out a pound of phosphorus inside the Lynn Haven watershed, you're talking about our most developed section of our city. And the land costs to create BMPs, to create the Tier 1 and Tier 2 type of phosphorus-removing BMPs. These kind of investments are running upwards and over $30,000 a pound. And as a result, if you take that 390 and you multiply it times 30,000, that one line is $11 million in investment to try to remove that. Our efforts that Melanie's doing is to look at some of our projects to find some of our current BMPs to create some tier level two without having to invest quite that amount of money. But in some instances, we're going to be faced with the creation of additional BMPs to start to collect that water and to be able to remove those TMDL requirements. And that's just getting after the phase one, which is that 5% of our total mission, knowing that phase two is 35% and phase three is 65%. So it's some crazy numbers.
I recommend the state to re-engage the EPA and OPM, OMB under the new administration and renegotiate the terms of our permit. Okay. This is ridiculous. This is really puts a huge burden on families. And I think this is just the kind of thing the new administration is asking us to come and tell them what's dumb. Right. And what doesn't make economic sense? This is crazy.
Unfortunately, in court cases that Chesapeake Bay Foundation brought against the EPA and won in court, and those kind of federal court cases EPA's passing that down to our DAEQ.
It's worthy of re-engagement in this light.
I'm there. I'm signing up for that, Mr. Moss. It's just I'm at the bottom of the food chain here as a manager of the city, and so we're gonna hopefully, before we get out of the 5%, we get into that 35% in that second five-year window. I'm hoping you're right.
Well, not to lay the point. My point is the cost of these things are so huge, and how they translate to homeowners. Homeowners become an endangered species themselves because of the cost of these things. There's got to be a better balance. There has to be a better balance.
Absolutely.
Okay. CIP 706 is the Elizabeth River TMDL implementation plan, which includes, again, identification, design, and construction of projects to meet requirements for both the Chesapeake Bay and the local bacteria TMDLs within this watershed. Our main project underway currently is the Kemp's Lake retrofit, and that was the one that we received the SLAF funding for. It's planned to go to construction in the fall of 2017. This project is going to be adding pretreatment, four bays, wetlands. It'll have minor dredging for the four bays and wetlands and aeration as well. And this is to improve the water quality of the water leaving the lake at the south end of the photo and going to the Elizabeth River. The current funding is $200,000 per year with an additional need of $920,000 per year. 713 is the Lynn Haven watershed, similar to the Elizabeth. So this Lynn Haven watershed, though, it's a high-priority watershed. It's also located in the Chesapeake Bay, like the Elizabeth. And last year, we completed our first stream restoration project, which is shown in the photos on the right. That was Mill Dam Creek. And that project cost was about $750,000. We are focused right now on identification, design, and construction of many additional projects in this watershed to address our requirements for both, again, the Chesapeake Bay TMDL, and again, we have a local bacteria TMDL in this watershed. The current funding is $309,000 per year, with an additional need of $733,000 per year. The Southern River TMDL implementation plan, CIP 7410, includes the Back Bay, North Landing, and Northwest River watersheds. And even though this part of our city flows south and not to the Chesapeake Bay, again, there are still permit requirements to implement projects and programs as well to address the local TMDLs for both phosphorus and bacteria in these waterways. So these same types of projects are going to need to be identified, designed, and constructed to meet the requirements to reduce pollution in these waterways. The current funding is $200,000 per year with an additional need of $208,000 per year. 7043 is water quality and restoration participation projects, and we've used this to take advantage of cost participation opportunities with the Army Corps of Engineers focused on water quality restoration. So the first phase of the Lynn Haven River Basin Ecosystem Restoration Project is in the design phase, and we're going to be constructing reef habitat, submerged aquatic vegetation, and wetlands with this project. The city's share of that first phase, it's a 65-35% split, and for the first phase, it's going to be $2.25 million. This project has a current funding of $50,000 per year with an additional one-time need of $750,000 for the construction of that first phase. And now I'd like to introduce Mark Johnson, who's going to talk with you all about the operations and maintenance portion.
We welcome you.
Well, thank you. Thank you for having me. I'm going to talk about eight projects that are maintenance projects. Maintenance projects basically support activities which fund individual tasks or projects within those activities. First one I'm going to talk about is lake and canal management. Basically, there's 760 lakes throughout the city. This project funds dredging of those lakes. To date, we've dredged 10 lakes. We are currently in Windsor Oaks in one canal. We're going to start another canal in Windsor Oaks later on this year, and then we're going to move over to Green Run 2. In FY18, we're going to work on Windsor Oaks 3, finish up the remaining three lakes in Green Run Canal, and then we're going to work on some smaller lakes.
I have a question, and
no problem.
When you say lakes, they're BMPs, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I just kind of remember a while back when we first started requiring the BMPs,
And I kind of remember the conversation around this table being, well, in the future, who's going to be taking care of these BMPs? And we kind of sort of said, well, we don't know exactly, but it's probably going to be the city, right? And so here we are at the time of having to do this. Some of these, I guess, are the responsibility of homeowners associations, and some are the city. Do we have a breakdown in that? And
I can. I think I can give you a breakdown. The lakes that were built with subdivisions, I'll say in the 90s, have better ties from the easements to the homeowners associations with their responsibility to maintain the lakes. The earlier lake systems with the earlier development subdivision developments in the 70s and 80s, they have less requirements for the homeowners association to do on those lakes. So what we do when we put together a list and we look at a lake to see if we need to dredge it, we also look at the easements to see who is required to maintain what portion of the lake.
And knowing that some of these homeowners associations, that's a pretty mammoth job for them to do. And then, of course, when they get the algae blooms and there's all that concern about whether they're going to be able to take care of that and so forth, do you have some sort of overall plan or overall statement of these lakes and what's happening and so forth, just so we can each be, I mean, we see what happens, you know, we saw it last week, you know, when we have one that, of course, was a borrow pit, so that's much bigger than a BMP. What happens when it does have a problem? And, you know, then the neighbors are, you know, they don't know where to turn and what to do, but, this is not just our natural environment, this is the environment that was created so that we could develop.
Right.
And, you know, so in being able to develop some of these lands, and I'm looking at these that are under construction now, the first thing they had to do is go in and put in their stormwater ponds, and then the stormwater ponds become a problem, and, you know, it's a vicious circle, and, you know, it's enough having to deal with our natural environment, but now when we also have to deal with the man-made part of it, it's overwhelming, and I think that's what's happening to folks, and particularly in their neighborhoods when they look at their lakes, and how in the world are we ever going to do 760 lakes? I mean, it's
daunting. Basically, where we are with the lake dredging program, to do all the lakes we feel we need to do today, it's about 95 years. Okay,
yeah.
to do the top 50 lakes, based on funding today, it'll get us to 2026. Okay, so that's the task we have, but also in the maintenance projects, we've set up projects or activities to address all the various issues, you know, that come to us from stormwater. You'll see in another project I'll talk about in a minute. The residential cost participation, where last year we did add a lake management portion to it, where if a homeowner association that has a lake, if they develop a lake management plan, we will cost participate with them on a 50-50 basis for their first treatment. And the goal is to get them started and get their lake back to a condition where they can themselves maintain it, and then they're off and running. And we'll provide them support if they have questions about what should I do and everything, we'll offer that. But that's the whole goal for that, and I'll talk about that project. But the whole idea is we have different components within the system that we have to maintain, and each of these ongoing programs address an individual portion of that component. So the whole thing is progressing, and we're maintaining the whole system. Now, each of those programs are funded at various levels, but that's what we have to deal with, and that's what we use to proceed on. So if I can move to the next project real quick.
Yeah, but it scares me because we're still doing the same old thing with every new development. There's a new thing. Okay, we'll come to the conclusion in 95 years, huh?
Yes, ma'am. Okay, oceanfront stormwater facility maintenance. This is a maintenance program for the Army Corps of Engineers beach erosion and hurricane protection project. It's the largest flood control project the city has. Interesting, it's almost 20 years old. There's 617 joints along the concrete boardwalk. There's 40 sets of steps. The current funding level is about $750,000 a year. What we're projecting an additional need of $900,000 a year just to keep up with maintenance. The Army Corps of Engineers comes down and inspects every year. Right now, we are rated at an acceptable level of the condition of the overall facility. So we do need to do some maintenance. The next project, primary system infrastructure improvements. This project supplements the in-house off-road ditch program we have with funds for contract work. Basically, we use contractors, I'll call it up in the developed section of the city, and we focus our in-house forces down in the farm country, Princess Anne District. Currently, it's funded at $2.27 million a year, an additional need of $500,000 we're projecting for that. The next project is the residential cost participation project, which I was just talking about. Originally, it funds, and it still does, cost participation for piping ditches, specifically in residential areas. If you have a ditch in front of your house, you want to pipe it, you can cost participate with us, and we'll do that. But last year, we established the lake management portion of it. Again, if their lake owners want to get together, they want to develop a lake management program to treat their lake. We'll get with them. If they can develop the program, we'll cost participate 50-50 on the effort, and we'll get them up and running. So far, we have five lakes that are interested in participating. I appreciate Lake Dowdy for being the first one in. We had to work through some issues, but they worked with us, and I really appreciate that. Right now, the program fund is $50,000. We're projecting a need of $100,000 in addition. Stormwater infrastructure maintenance rehabilitation. This is where we go into developments. We first clean the pipe system. We inspect the pipe system. We identify maintenance needs. We design the fix to the maintenance needs, and then we go in and fix it. It's a systematic thing that we roll through the neighborhoods. We just finished up Green Run at about $2.7 million. We're still in Glenwood and Pine Ridge. Next year, we're going to move over to Kings Grant and Magic Hollow. In addition to that, what we're seeing is we have about 10 miles of corrugated metal pipe throughout the city. And the age on some of that pipe is between 50 and 40 years. And we're starting to see issues that are cropping up, and it's going to be a bigger issue as in the near future. So we take some of this money and we devote to that, but it's going to be a bigger issue. And we also do small drainage projects with respect to subdivisions. That'll be improving an outfall that's failed, but smaller jobs. Current funding, $5.7 million. Projected an additional need, $4 million a year. Stormwater pump station maintenance. We have 15 pump stations. We've developed a program here where we're going to go into each pump station and overhaul it and rehabilitate it. This year we're finishing up 16th Street Pump Station, where we've invested almost $600,000 in that pump station. Rebuild the 342,000 GPM pumps, upgrade all the electronics to today's technology. And the idea is we will systematically march through all the pump stations throughout the city. Right now, we're funded at a level where we can do one pump station a year. We're projecting additional need of $1 million to really get after this program. The next project is above target project, Hollis and Pleasure House Road, Shore Drive and Church Point Drainage. This project is to analyze, begin preliminary design of the drainage system that where the upper reach of the drainage area is basically the ditch between Church Point and Thoroughgood. That's how far this drainage area reaches, and it discharges into Lake Bradbury over at Little Creek. And that's how far the expanse of it is. The two pictures you see is Shore Drive last July, right after the day that we had that thunderstorm that dumped about almost 8 inches of water in that area within an hour. And these are pictures of Shore Drive the day after. Okay, and then that has a above target need of $3 million. Next project is a proposed canal management project. What we've discovered is we have canal systems through some of our older subdivisions that are larger than off-road ditches, but they're not quite the same as lakes. They're more linear. It takes a different type of construction activity to get in and excavate them back out. So we are proposing this so that these canal systems do not have to compete with the lakes that we're trying to dredge, and we'll have a standing fund source to go after these canals. And we're proposing a target of about $2 million a year. Okay, we'll close with this slide that Phil showed you earlier. Basically, it just splits up the above target projects into four areas. It's the flood control projects related to the recent major storm events, the flood control projects, which are called the legacy projects, the water quality projects and regulatory compliance projects, and the operations and maintenance projects I just spoke about. So,
Shannon,
are any questions?
Why are those four highlighted?
The four are highlighted because they were identified, and as a result of Tropical Storm Julia, Hurricane Tropical Storm Matthew, which really showed the need to do these jobs.
They're new projects, Ms. Kane, and Windsor's not highlighted because it's been in the system. We just haven't been able to get the funding to do it.
That's my real question.
I know where. Okay. I know right where you're at.
I think
you
had a handle on that one, John Moss.
I know we have like four watersheds and 31 drainage systems that we have. It would be interesting when we're looking through all these projects to see these projects in the context of the water circulatory system of the city, so you could understand the systems of systems and what you get. Because one of the things I have a trouble with as I look at the project individually is obviously it's hard to go back and re-baseline based on what we now know and what the risks are. Or just because you're in the program doesn't mean you should stay in. And how we go about, I know you're going to come back with that later, but I really need a way, I'll invent my own if I have to, but I would like to have a common way to assess. And if it was by those drainage systems, we could look at the systems, the performance, then you could have a more data-based assessment of which projects give us the biggest bang for the buck. And that's what's hard to do from this.
Couldn't agree with you more, Councilman.
Any other questions or comments? Dave, this report from the police is very good that we're getting next, I believe, but I'm supposed to go into closed session at 5:15. Mark, how much time do you need?
I can take as short or as long as you need, but I think 15, 20 minutes.
Okay, so let's keep going.
Right.
Okay.
Yep.
Keep
Thank
that
you,
in mind.
Mark. Thanks, team. Appreciate it.
The animal care and adoption sort of thing.
Yes, sir.
It's impressive what I've read over the weekend.
This is probably more a council, but Mr. Wood, you asked that police department come forward. They've been in operation, so I defer to you.
Well, Councilman Dyer and I are the liaisons to the Animal Control Advisory Board, and as Bobby can attest as well, they do some fantastic work with a group of citizens who work with police and with the adoption groups, and they do a great job. And they do this report every year, and they send it to us, but it's been a while since they've done that. And I think when you see the beginning of this report, remember where we were just a few short years ago and where we are now.
I wasn't kidding when I said I read this thing, and I do remember where we were and where we've come, and this is good information. Tony, we're glad to have you.
Good afternoon. Good to see you, Mr. Mayor, council members, Mr. Hansen, distinguished guests. Chief Severa sends his regrets. He had a scheduling conflict at the 23rd hour, so he asked me to stand in. And we were very pleased to have this opportunity to give a report out on the animal shelter five-year benchmark. As you recall, after a lot of discussion and council support, there was a new animal control shelter that was built. It started construction in July of 2010. We opened it up in December of 2011. It's a 39,000 square foot facility. The funding stream was about $12 million that council put forward to support this project. It's a state-of-the-art building that was built with certifications on the LEED certifications. It has 20 separate air conditioning zones and filters so the air doesn't cross-pollinate and helps to keep our individuals inside, the canine and felines, safe from contaminants. It houses about 187 dogs and 137 cats. It has a full-service adoption area. We have a surgical suite with a full-time vet. And we'll speak about our volunteer effort, but we have about 300 active adult volunteers that help us deliver our services to this shelter in our community. What I want to do is introduce our shelter manager, Ms. Julene Balance, to offer the details on the shelter. But I also want to identify with us today is Ms. L.D. Davis. She's the chairperson of our Animal Control and Animal Board Advisory. Captain Adams, who's the commanding officer of Special Operations, and Lieutenant Shannon Wichendahl, who's our lead animal enforcement unit team member. So with that, I'd like to ask Ms. Julene to step up and deliver the presentation.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Thanks for having me here and all of us. We wanted to share with you our progress of the new shelter. And I'm going to give you a little history of where we've been. The deputy chief has touched on that already, but I'll expand on it and be mindful of your time as well. But our up until about 5 years ago, we had a milestone in December of 2016 of 5 years at the new facility. But prior to the new facility, this was our home on Leroy Road. And at the time it was built, it was really a state-of-the-art facility 40 years ago. And, of course, animals are hard on a building, and over the years it became in disrepair, and it was hard for us to keep up with industry standards, which were really quickly evolving, particularly over the last decade. So we got to a point where there was really we were in jeopardy of noncompliance with the state veterinarian's office, and city council approved funding for our new facility. So we moved in December of 2011. Let's see if this clicker works here. So our objectives with the new building were to increase and promote adoptions, increase our marketing, exposure to the public, and have a more accessible facility. Rather than being on the edge of Pungo, we're now close to the interstate off of Birdneck Road. We wanted to manage our disease outbreaks a little more effectively and do on-site surgical procedures as well as disease management with medications and things of that nature. And we wanted to improve our community relations and really meet and exceed council's expectations of us, and also uphold the community expectations for animals. As you know, our community really finds that very important. So we wanted to move into a facility where we could achieve higher success. And we wanted it to be a green building. So this building, when it was all said and done, became a LEED certified silver facility. So this is, you can see from the pictures, it's quite a bit different than the first slide. We're a 38,000 square foot building. It's state of the art. If you haven't visited, you should. Please come down. It's inviting, and it really, when you walk in, it's bright, and it really says that we're an adoption-friendly facility, which was the ultimate goal. So we hit 5 years in December of 2016. And what we've been able to achieve just by moving into the new building is to increase our events and our exposure, on-site and off-site events. We have routine engagement via social media and some free marketing avenues that are very successful. We've increased our foster program, and we do enrichment activities that we were unable to do because of the old facility. It kind of hindered our involvement. And we have a wonderful, well-trained staff and group of volunteers. As the deputy chief mentioned, we have approximately 300 adult volunteers, and we have another 150 or so youth with an ebb and flow, of course, but they donate a tremendous amount of hours, which we'll touch on later in the presentation. So without going through each one of these bullet points, we do try to engage the community and all members of the community and welcome them into the facility. We try to give back to many groups. So one of the groups that's near and dear to my heart are the special needs groups. We have them come in and do some work experience at the shelter. They give to us by donating time, but of course they're also learning skills that they can use elsewhere in their lives. We do some visitation to senior facilities with pets. We interact with school groups and children and try to teach them responsible pet ownership techniques so that they can be responsible owners later on down the line. And our volunteers, we really have grown this program. This program started about a decade ago at the old facility. And here at our new facility, we have grown to this just this past year. Adult volunteers alone donated almost 60,000 hours of volunteer service, which is really impressive to me considering 300. While that's an impressive number, it's even more impressive when you think that just that 300 donated 60,000 hours. So we really try to engage them in different activities. So I've listed them here for you, but they're engaged in foster parenting at home. There are people that want to come to the shelter, people that want to give back without coming to the shelter. So we engage them in many different ways. And the value of their service to us was about $1.4 million just last year. So when you look at our five-year statistics, we are looking at almost 200,000 hours of volunteer service just for our facility and over $4 million worth of value from our volunteerism. So one of the primary...
Yeah, you got one quick question. Sorry. John,
I know that one of the compelling reasons for us to go ahead and build the new centers, we were having a hard time maintaining our volunteers at the old place. I know you really started this after it opened. Do you have any sense of how that increased our number of volunteer hours at the new facility, and if so, roughly what the percentage is?
So I didn't include prior to 2011 on this presentation, but I have been around for a while. So if I'm going from my memory bank.
Not to take up your time, yeah. But if you wouldn't mind sending that out, and just because it'd be
send it later.
I imagine it's pretty.
It's significant. Yeah, we had a small core group of volunteers at the old shelter, and I'm meaning like double digits.
That's
so I don't. It we went from probably a few thousand hours a year to what we're at now. But I can get real numbers for you.
Wouldn't mind. That'd be helpful. Sure. Thank you.
Okay. So one of our primary goals with the new shelter certainly was to increase what in the industry they call a live release rate. So how successful are we sending animals back out into the community? So for 2016, our overall all live release rate was at 75%. If we break it down by species, we're at 92% for dogs and 55% for cats. That's just for 2016. And in the animal industry, over 90% is considered no-kill. So what we are really is an open admission shelter, meaning we take in literally everything. We never turn anybody away as long as the animal is from Virginia Beach or the citizen is from Virginia Beach. So it's impressive that while we're not considered a no-kill facility, we have reached that level, taking in everything and not doing any kind of managed intakes. And backing up a slide, the cat rate has increased with the new shelter, and that is our area of improvement moving forward, which I'll touch on later. So for the last 5 years, if we look cumulatively, our dog live release rate averages out above the 90% range. Our cats are hovering around 50%, and then our overall percentage is at 72%. So it's always interesting to me to note how we're doing compared with our sister agencies in the region. So what I've done here is compare other municipal open admission shelters. So you'll notice that organizations that you might be familiar with, such as the Virginia Beach SPCA, is not on here just because they're solely a private facility. They don't operate as the city's facility. But in terms of Chesapeake Animal Control, Peninsula Regional, Norfolk Animal Care and Adoption, and Portsmouth Humane being private but contracted for the city, we are the front runner for dog live release rate. And for cats, we come in under Portsmouth Humane, but it's important to note our volume is triple that of Portsmouth. So just, you know, when you're reviewing the stats, if you'd take that into consideration. And then we wanted to compare also to other agencies that are matched with cities similar to the Virginia Beach population. It's a tricky comparison, really, because no shelter is exactly created equal. Either their intakes are going to be higher or lower, or maybe they manage their intake somehow. So it's difficult to find a really apples-to-apples comparison. But if you look at Charlotte, North Carolina, and Long Beach, California, those are two cities that have a similar population to Virginia Beach. We are really, we're really doing well comparatively. I included Richmond on here just because it is in Virginia, and it's our a population that is second closest to Virginia Beach. And they are at the 87% range for all species. So, what's important to note about Richmond is they operate slightly differently. They do manage their intake. So while they call themselves an open admission shelter, they are making some different decisions on the front end with their intakes pertaining to cats. So moving forward, cats, that's where we want to focus. We want all of our numbers and our overall live release rate to increase to that above 90% threshold. That's our goal. Our challenge right now is really with unsocialized cats that we take in. Probably about 40% of the cats that we're intaking through the facility are unsocialized or feral, and they're not appropriate to put into homes. So that's our current challenge. Some of the other facilities that are successful with this challenge are making policy decisions on intake. So it's just a conversation that we want to have moving forward into the future on the ethics of that and how what's appropriate for Virginia Beach. And we're going to do that in conjunction with our Animal Control Advisory Board. We're going to engage them in that conversation moving forward. Our primary need right now are staffing positions. So just to give you an idea, 7,000 animals annually on average are passed through our doors. And those animals are cared for by 10 full-time caretakers. That's it. And they are hardworking people. And four clerks doing all of our adoptions and all of our reunifications with owners. So it's a really limited staff. So our volunteers really support those efforts. But of course, there are duties that are really specific to staff. So that is it's been our most basic need for the past few years. So as we move forward, we'll continue to go through the channels to request additional funding for those positions. And just to recap our goals, it is our goal to increase our live release rate, and we're going to do that by focusing on cats in the future. We want to improve our marketing. We want to increase our educational opportunities and our outreach to the public. And we're going to be looking at doing some job reassessments and looking for some growth opportunities for our caretaker staff. We want to engage them and retain them as much as possible. And then we're going to continue to look at operational changes that can be made in order to increase our efficiency, look for technological options with software programs and things of that nature. So our animal enforcement team works out of our building as well. They have a wing within the shelter, and together we provide holistic animal services for the community. So it's not just the shelter. I know most of this presentation was focused on the shelter, but the animal enforcement team, they are the primary component that brings the animals to us. So we really work together. They bring them to us, and then we house them and place them back in the community.
Okay, we got a question or two. Shannon?
I thought maybe she was done. If you want to finish, I just want to give you kudos on a couple things.
Okay, we'll come back to Shannon. Okay. Go right ahead.
Yes, sir. So there are 21 animal control officers that work for the animal control, the animal enforcement unit. So those 21 officers were dispatched to over 22,000 calls in 2016. About 1,400 of those were bite reports. It's important to note that bite reports are down from previous year, 2015, as are cruelty complaints. So not sure if that's going to be an emerging trend or not, but would like to think that that's due to their enforcement efforts. They've issued over 1,200 summonses, and out of 240-some animal cruelty investigations, resulted in 37 charges for animal cruelty.
What's the animal up there on the right?
It's a pelican. They get into trouble sometimes. So it's one of the animal control officers helping them. And okay. You can see they deal with a variety. I tried to show you guys a variety of things that they do. Not a dull moment in their side of the world.
A dog with his head stuck in there.
But that concludes the presentation, okay. And I thank you for your time.
Hey, Shannon, you had a question?
I just wanted to say what a great job you guys are doing. We just got a new puppy a few weeks ago. So for 3 or 4 weeks straight on Saturday, we ventured down to the Animal Control Center as well as other places throughout the city. And I have to say, hands down, you guys have done a much better job than any other place that we visited. My son is a little scared of dogs, so we got him one. but your volunteers came in, and they worked in the room with him and tried to show him how to approach the dog. I mean, they really, really worked with him on that and spent a lot of time that that they didn't really have to spend, that mm-hmm. no one else did in the city anywhere else. So you guys did a really good job. It was clean. Everyone was polite. I couldn't have had a better experience. It was every single time that we went in, so it wasn't just one time.
Bobby, Jim, and Jessica.
Yeah, thank you. And I just want to also give kudos not only to Jolene and her staff, but to the police department. It seems like to be a wonderful working relationship that's evolved into LD. And
the volunteers that work on the board of directors and everything. And needless to say, it's an understatement to say that when it comes to animals, you know, people are passionate and emotional about it. If we remember during hurricane evaluations, people wouldn't leave their dogs. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they got the group deals with a group of people that are strong advocates and, you know, a lot of people trying to get involved, and they navigate beautifully. But the other thing is, too, they take care of a lot of the abuses to animals, too. And, you know, when we consider the situation we have on Leroy Drive with the parvo outbreaks and the sanitary conditions and everything, we made a 180. And, you know, so kudos to all of you for a team effort that really has been very successful.
Jim, then Jessica.
Yeah, I just wanted to echo what both Shannon and Bobby said. You know, my parents went down and got a beagle from the animal control place, and that dog, as you know, has a great life now. He does very well. But I'll also tell you the issue with the volunteers has been incredibly good. We have had, I guess Bobby and I probably know more about feral cats now than we
ever wanted to know. Yes.
By the way, a group is called a colony. More than one feral cat or a group is a colony. We learned that, but the advocates are, that's an important issue, because there are so many people who have very strong opinions about animals. It's like the way people deal with their children, and they do a phenomenal job. Julene does, and the police department is Shannon, the other Shannon, and they do a great job, kind of brokering all of these yep. these differing philosophies and views, and it's tense. I mean, we've had more than a few tense meetings. You know, with only a few people sitting around a table, it's like a budget hearing, almost at times, with the screaming and yelling. But it's really they've done a great job. And I would just say again to Julene and Shannon and the others there, they do a phenomenal job down there, both on the shelter side and the enforcement side.
Great, thank you, Jessica.
You guys are awesome. Big fan of rescue, my family. All of our dogs are rescue animals. But I had a couple questions about the dogs you guys pick up, and this might be more directed to animal control. What is the, do you guys keep track of how many of those animals are picked up and they're not licensed or tagged properly? I know last year I picked up 3 Goldens that got out of the neighbor's yard, and the animal control officer that responded said that, you know, there's no way they weren't pets because they were walking together very friendly, and they were on Prince Sam Road, so, you know, we had to stop and get them. But he had mentioned to me in passing that the owners are not always, I guess, fined if their animals get out and are not properly licensed and tagged. So do you, more for, I guess, a recidivism with cats specifically, is that contributing, or should we be looking at measures to making sure our cats are more properly tagged? I mean, I know it's hard to tag a cat because their collars come off so easily, but my curiosity, because this is an issue facing almost all major municipalities with the way that they breed and not being fixed, is there efforts that we can be taking to help? Well, I guess my two questions is a lot of this cat issue a recidivism problem, or is it that it's just we have a feral cat problem?
So I looked at our feral cat numbers for 2016 right before I came here. So just to give you an idea, 800 cats were euthanized last year for the reason of being feral. So if I were to, let's say we hadn't taken in those feral cats, if we were to extract that number and then do our live release rate over again, it would have increased by 11%. Mm-hmm. So we do think there's a little room for, there's definitely room for increase of reclaims. Mm-hmm. Reclaim rate for cats has historically been very low. It hovers at about 50% for dogs, and it has remained constant for years, one of the highest in the region. So we've done some things with nextdoor.com for some targeting, like targeted marketing to neighborhoods. We've done that over the last couple of years to try to increase that for cats. We haven't seen the increase. So I do think that there's a difference in philosophy with ownership of cat owners, and also we have a transient community. So I think there's an educational piece, you know, that cats, you know, shouldn't just be put outside if, you know, if you can't keep them anymore. So I do think that's a part of the problem. But I also think that when that happens, then over time and generations of cats, then you've got feral cat problem.
Right.
So, you know, I think the biggest punch for it, if you will, if we were to address the feral cat problem, our rates would increase immediately.
Okay.
To almost the level of 90%. Yeah.
All right, great. I'm speaking for the entire council. Tony, everyone down there is doing a great job. Volunteers are doing great. I come to work and see the volunteers walking the dogs on Verneck Road all the time. Very neat to see. But and to Jim and Bobby being the liaisons, I remember well the situation that was there many years ago, and to see where we are today. Great report, good news.
And Mr. Mayor, if I may just close with the remarks for first thanking the body for allowing us to help celebrate this 5-year benchmark. I want to send out my personal regards to both Councilman Dyer and Wood. But clearly, while this is a brick and mortar construction, the staff, the volunteers, and the community have made us and enabled us to offer these remarks to celebrate this 5-year benchmark, and it's our privilege to share this information with you.
Thank you so much. We appreciate you taking time. Dave, I'll give you 5 minutes on disparity.
I'll be less than that. Okay. Members of council, and thank you very much for the brief, everybody. On Friday, the staff joined me in a meeting with Mr. Bruce Smith, Mr. Ed Hamm, and Ama Gutierrez of the she's the chairman of the Minority Business Council. We took our disparity study, and first of all, we shared with them the Columbus, Ohio study that had 30-plus pages and made sure that we were clear and understanding, and we showed them 7 or 8 other studies so that we clearly understand that doing business on an RFP with a government requires certain legal requirements. Dana Harmeyer joined me, Patty Phillips joined me, and Taylor as the staff side. We had a very cordial 2.5-hour line by line, paragraph by paragraph, point by point discussion. I bring to your attention 2 points that they surfaced, and it made sense to me, and so I bring it to you today. There is a concern about when you are engaged in an RFP and have a consultant that the potential perception of the public that giving a presentation in front of the council at the end of each task order may be deemed as potentially affecting the way the consultant might pursue the findings, the assessment, and the recommendations of each of those tasks. And so what I'm coming before you today is to let you know that I would recommend to the body that we that we still maintain that at the completion of each task, there will be a required written report so that you actually get to see the findings, and that that will be the end of their requirement for each task, and that we avoid having the presentation. The staff manager of the study is Patty Phillips, our finance director. She will be required to maintain, and that they have the consultant has a monthly requirement to do billings and everything, but they will be presenting.
Okay, so we get a written report.
And so you get a written report, and we strike the other. The other line that we would strike from the RFP is located at 2 locations. Should the city council authorize all 3 tasks? And the conversation right now is, if we're going to do a full disparity study, we're going to authorize all 3 tasks to go forward. You're going to have an appropriation requirement for each one of those, because they are going to give you a by-task cost associated with that.
And you're recommending all of this.
I'm recommending
Johnny, something real quick.
Just real quick. I just want to make sure that all the stakeholders agree with the methodology. Because in the end, if there's not agreement on the methodology, we spend a lot of money.
Yes, sir. So
that's always been my concern, that all the stakeholders agree on the methodology.
Yes, sir. In response to that question, we went through line by line the methodology. We went through each of the task orders, and I think we're going to get to agreement here.
We'll move forward then, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, council. In accordance with the Virginia Beach City Code, Section 2.21, and by the Authority vested in me as mayor of the city of Virginia Beach, I hereby call for a special formal session of Virginia Beach City Council Tuesday, March 14th at 5:15 p.m. City Council Conference Room 234-2401 Courthouse Drive. The purpose of the special formal session is to conduct a closed session for the sole purpose of discussing the proposed arena. The regularly scheduled City Council workshop will begin at 4 p.m. for briefings by various departments regarding the fiscal year 2017-18 capital improvement program as part of the budget allocations.
That's all you need right there, the purpose is
it. I don't need to do anything else. Mr. City Attorney?
You just need to read the motion to go into closed.
That's what I was just...
Okay.
You have to have a motion.
Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
He did read it. I heard it.
Any? Call the roll.
Davenport. Mrs. Abbott.
Close them. Yep, we haven't voted.
Bob Dyer.
Aye.
Mrs. Henley.
Aye. Wait.
You've read the letter calling the special meeting. Now there's a separate document that you have to read for the motion.
I just asked for it. I was told I didn't need it.
Yes, sir, you do. I gave it to you, but I have another copy if you don't have it.
Make a motion or order.
That sounds good enough to me.
We have to sign a code session.
The chair will entertain a motion to recess into a closed session pursuant to the exemptions from open meetings allowed by Section 2.2-37118 Code of Virginia, submitted for the following purposes: legal matters, consultation with legal counsel employed or retained by a public body regarding specific legal matters requiring the provision of legal advice by such counsel pursuant to Section 2.2-37118 Arena Project. Do I have a motion?
Second.
Call the roll, please.
Mrs. Abbott?
Here.
Mr. Davenport? Mr. Dyer?
Aye.
Mrs. Henley?
Aye.
Mr. Jones?
Aye.
Mrs. Kane?
Aye.
Moss?
Aye.
Mr. Hearn?
Aye.
Mrs. Wilson?
Aye.
Mr. Wood?
Aye.
Mayor Simpson?
Aye. 10-0. Thank you. If you shut the doors down.